Hello and welcome to the International Daily Roundup by People's Dispatch, where we bring you major news developments from around the world. Our headlines: Israeli airstrike on Gaza enters second week, death toll reaches 200. Independents and progressives secure majority of seats in Chile's constitutional convention. And widespread condemnation marks terror tagging of peace activists in Philippines. In our first story, Israel's air offensive on the occupied Palestinian territory of Gaza continued with fresh strikes on Monday. At least 42 people were killed on Sunday alone, bringing the total Palestinian death toll to 192, including 58 children. At least 1,200 more people have been injured. The Israeli Air Force has carried out at least 55 air raids inside Gaza within the first few hours of Monday. This was the heaviest since the strikes began last Monday, following Hamas' retaliatory rocket launches over the violent Israeli storming of the Al-Aqsa Mosque in occupied East Jerusalem. The Israeli air offensive on civilian areas in Gaza has led to massive destruction of property and infrastructure and displaced thousands of people. On Saturday, Israeli air offensive also led to the bombing of a multi-story building housing international media houses such as Al Jazeera and Associated Press. The bombardment has also destroyed power lines, leading to electricity cuts and blackouts in several parts of Gaza. Several families have reportedly been buried under the debris of the bombed houses. Palestinian civil defense volunteers have been digging people out of these debris. Israel's caretaker Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu said on Sunday that the strikes in Gaza will continue in full force. Meanwhile, Hamas said that it fired fresh rockets on the Israeli cities of Ashkelon and Beersheba on Sunday. According to Israeli official reports, at least 10 people have died in Hamas retaliatory attacks since May 10th. Several countries have called for an immediate cessation of hostilities. On Sunday, the UN Security Council met for the second time to discuss the situation, but again failed to come to a consensus on issuing a formal statement. Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Yi said that the failure to issue a statement was due to obstructions created by the US. The US has officially supported the Israeli aggression inside Gaza, calling it Israel's right to self-defense. On May 10th, after the first emergency meeting of the Security Council, the US had blocked the release of a statement proposed by Norway despite the support of 14 countries of the 15-member council. In the meanwhile, the Russian Deputy Foreign Minister Sergei Vershinin also addressed the meeting and asked for an urgent meeting of the Middle East Quartet, composed of the UN, the US, Russia and the European Union. Russia has called for the quartet to mediate the peace process between Israel and Palestine. In our video section, we take a look at the developments in East Jerusalem that actually sparked the crisis. Asal Abdul Khadir of the Union of Palestinian Women's Committees talks about the demographic project of Israel in Palestine.
So when we want to talk about Jerusalem and what's happening in Jerusalem and the policies that the occupation is trying to implement there, we have to go back to history and what happened in East Jerusalem, because this is all part of what happened and still happening until now. So to start with, in 1948, as we all know, the terrorist Zionist gangs occupied parts of Palestine, including the west side of Jerusalem. After this, the illegal annexation and colonial occupation of the east side of Jerusalem in 1967, in addition to the excessive use of physical force and land acquisition, Israel has worked to develop laws and policies that would enable it to seize control and expand its settler colonial project throughout Palestine. So it has applied Israel domestic laws in East Jerusalem. After that, in 1974, a radical Israel settler group called Rosh Emunim built the first settlement in East Jerusalem, which is called Ma'ali Adumim, in contravention of international law, which considers East Jerusalem as an occupied Palestinian territory. This they did that by theft, forgery, and confiscation of lands. And by this illegal building of these settlements, Israel has segregated the city from the rest of the occupied territory. Physically, it has disrupted the contiguity of the occupied Palestinian territory, preventing any political chance of having a Palestinian state in the future, of course. These illegal settlements in East Jerusalem besieged Palestinian villages, preventing its natural geographic development and expansion, and also by the construction of the bypass roads that serve only the movement of settlers between East and West Jerusalem. And bypassing dozens, another way of controlling East Jerusalem is passing a dozen laws and procedures that limits the urban expansion of Palestinians in East Jerusalem due to the lack of structured planning in the marginalized Palestinian villages, which is the responsibility of the occupying power. So under the pretext, Israel prevents Palestinians from building and frequently demolishes Palestinian houses, which we can consider as an ethnic cleansing process. Furthermore, imposing a lot of taxes on Palestinians without any services, including the lack of adequate infrastructure or work opportunities. Over 80% of Palestinians in East Jerusalem are below the poverty line. Also trying to empty Jerusalem of its national and civil institutions by closing its headquarters and arresting its employees and consider them among the last of terrorism. Moreover, establishing institutions affiliated with the occupation municipality in East Jerusalem to impose the Israeli curriculums in Palestinian schools. Of course, the occupation is trying to control both sides of Jerusalem, East and West. And to do that, in order to implement that on the ground, they follow several policies. One of these policies is the building of the annexation wall, annexed and confiscated many Palestinians' land in order to implement the master plan for Jerusalem and make all of it the capital of Israel and the center of the Jewish people, right, where the demographic target for 2020 would constitute 60% Jews and 40% Arabs. Furthermore, the Israeli parliament, Knesset, has played a significant role in furthering Israel's demographic plans and reinventing a Jerusalem that fits one narrative and one people only, a Zionist Jewish narrative, by passing a basic law, Jerusalem, the capital of Israel, in 1980. That defines a united Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. The occupation wants to redraw the municipal borders of Jerusalem by the building of the wall to annex East Jerusalem and exclude Palestinian neighborhoods therein, and to annex instead settlements, which leads to the expelling of almost 150,000 Palestinians from the borders of Jerusalem. And of course, I want to talk about the laws. This all what I mentioned before is just to indicate the idea that Israel is an apartheid country that discriminates against Palestinians in all aspects of life. And now I'm going to mention how it discriminates against Palestinians and how it's an apartheid country when it comes to their laws and the laws that they establish. There are many Israel basic laws that we have to mention here to expose Israel's apartheid and discrimination against Palestinians. For example, the guardian of absentee property. This position was created based on the absentee Israel law in 1950. Which defines Palestinians who were expelled and displaced after 29th of November 1947, mainly after the Nakba and the war, as well as their movable and immovable properties, mainly lands, houses, and bank accounts, etc., as absentee. So Israel used that law to seize Palestinian lands and property. Another law is very important, the law of return in 1950, which gives any Jew in the world that hasn't any relation to Palestine to live in Palestine and have a citizenship. On the contrast, Palestinian refugees or displaced Palestinians that were forcibly expelled in 1948 don't have the right to return to their homes that were stolen by Jewish terrorist gangs. And another important law also is the Israeli nationality law in 1952, which gives any Jew from all over the world the Israeli citizenship while prevents Palestinians in East Jerusalem especially from any citizenship and consider the indigenous Palestinians, which are us, as residents in their own country. And last but not least, the basic law, Israel is a Jewish nation state law in 2018, which has distinct apartheid that guaranteed the ethnic religious character of Israel as exclusively Jewish, and while discrimination against Palestinian citizen and legitimizing exclusion, racism, and systematic inequality, encouraging the building of illegal settlements in contravention of international law. This is not all the law. These are not all the laws. There's a lot of laws. There's a lot of procedures that discriminates between Palestinians and Israelis. These are just an examples of these laws.
In our next story, preliminary results of the elections to Chile's upcoming constitutional convention have come in, and progressive and independent candidates are in the lead. Chile's electoral service has published 99% of the results so far. According to it, of the 155-member constitutional convention, the independent representatives coming from various social movements and trade unions will be the largest bloc with 48 seats. Of these, the 25 are part of the left-wing coalition of activists, the List of the People. Most of the independents were leaders and organizers of the 2019 protest demanding a new constitution. The left-wing alliance approved Dignity, constituting the Communist Party and Broad Front, won 28 seats. Traditional parties, on the other hand, suffered a resounding defeat. The ruling right-wing coalition Let's Go for Chile List won 37 seats, while the center-left neoliberal approval list secured only 25. Results for the 17 reserved seats for 10 indigenous tribes will be announced separately next week. This is the first time that a national lawmaking body is a representation for the indigenous Chileans, who constitute over a tenth of the population. Along with these elections, regional and municipal elections were also held for 16 governors, 345 mayors, and 2,240 municipal councillors. Although the final results of these elections will not be known until the end of the week, the preliminary results indicate a similar blow to the governing coalition. Rodrigo Mundaca, a prominent social leader and human rights defender, is expected to be the next governor of the region of Valparaiso, the second most populous region in the country. Similarly, Jorge Harp of the Broad Front will be re-elected as the mayor of the city of Valparaiso. In the meanwhile, Macarena Rivamontes of the Broad Front will become the mayor of Villa de Mar, a traditional right-wing bastion, and Daniel Jadu of the Communist Party will be re-elected as the mayor of Recoleta. Chilean President Sebastián Piñera conceded the overwhelming defeat of the ruling party and the traditional parties in the elections, and the dissatisfaction of the population towards him. And finally, activists and civil society groups in the Philippines continue to air their condemnation against the Anti-Terrorism Council's recently published list of so-called terrorists. The Philippines Ecumenical Peace Platform is the latest group to come out with a statement against the ATC's list of 29 terrorists last week. The PEPP is a coalition of various church-based groups advocating for a peace process and an end to the war between the communists and the Philippine state. In the statement, the PEPP warned of far-reaching and adverse repercussions on the dormant peace process between the Rodrigo Duterte government and the banned political arm of the banned Communist Party of the Philippines. Of the 29 individuals named, 19 were charged with being associated with the CPP and another 10 for being part of Moro secessionist groups. Of those accused being part of the CPP, most are already in jail or exile, such as the CPP leader Jose Maria Sison. But the list also includes 7 peace consultants for CPP's political arm, the National Democratic Front of Philippines. These are recognized as negotiators of the official peace process. Ever since the publication of the list of so-called terrorists on May 13th, civil society groups have raised alarm over the possible escalation of violence and the targeting of activists by government bodies. It has also renewed apprehensions about the ATC, which functions under the controversial Anti-Terrorism Act. That's all we have time for today. We'll be back tomorrow with more news from around the world. Until then, keep watching People's Dispatch.